Good day to you. You found us online at Second Congregational Church in Attleboro, Massachusetts. We are so glad that you have joined us today. Summer has begun, and we'll have an announcement, an update soon about our services, but I can tell you that we will be live streaming in July and August at 10 o'clock on Sunday mornings, right here, 10 o'clock on Sunday mornings. You can tune in or see that recorded version of the live stream at any time on Facebook. You don't have to have an account to see it on Facebook. So join us then. Well, I wanted to pray briefly for a few things that were brought to my attention this week. We pray because we can. We pray because we must. We pray because we believe that it releases something in us, not the least of which is this idea of empathy. We care for others as we think about them. We believe that God can change things. And we also consider whether or not we are the actual answers to the prayers that we pray, because God uses us by His Spirit to meet those needs. So I wanted to pray briefly for a few things. Let us pray. Dear God, we come to you with these requests that have been mentioned, and we realize that this is a recorded service, but there is no time frame with you. So we submit to you this need for Bill Black, the brother of our own Liz Hunt. He's up in Nova Scotia, as God well knows, but we pray for him because he's having a hard time and has been through some tough things. And we pray also for Liz, as for his sister, that you would comfort her, that you would encourage them, that you would bring healing to Bill's body. We pray for Don Grassi, who was in a motorcycle accident. He's now at Rhode Island Hospital in intensive care. We pray for his sister, Dawn. She has requested that we remember her brother at this time. We also remember an extended family member, Ramya, of our own Marsha Widener. We pray for her, both she and her husband and family, as she's dealing with COVID diagnosis and illness. And so we pray for her and all of those who've been affected by this virus. We pray healing on their bodies. We pray peace for their spirits. We pray strength for them and for their families. We remember Pearl Patrick, who died recently, her husband who passed away in April from COVID. We remember her, and we think of her, and we pray for those left behind who have been affected by her passing. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Now, friends, God calls into our midst those who are beloved in all of their diversity, so we welcome them. God calls into our midst all those who are vulnerable, in need of teaching, healing, and shelter, so we welcome them. God calls into our midst all those with a word of challenge that proclaims God's kingdom for all. We welcome them. Let us worship God, who calls us to be prophets of welcome. We welcome you in the Spirit. Alleluia. Let us worship together today.
Holy One, who calls us into community and invites us to welcome your prophets and messenger, let us experience your welcome to us, gathered in various places, but joined in this moment. Show us that we are beloved and honored in your presence and in this community. Show us how to put our resources at this service of all, and help us know that the cup of water given in your name nourishes the one who gives and the one who receives. Satisfy our thirst to know your presence here and now. God of all, you call us into obedience to the ways of life and holiness, to honor your image in all whom we meet. When we ration your welcome to a very few, God of abundance, you call us to stop clinging to things. When we grasp and hoard and do not share, God of hope, when we live the mission of the world of mercy and justice for all, we find a safe and joyful welcome waiting for our neighbors, children, and creation. Help us to be faithful messenger of such great news, even when we challenge to do what is right and good. We pray, Amen. Our scripture readings are from Genesis 12, 1 through 8. Now the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. And I will bless you of a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you and him who curse you, and I will curse. And by all the families of earth will bless themselves. So Abram went to the Lord had told him, and Lot with him. Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. And Abram took Sarai his wife, and Lot his brother's son, and all the possessions which they had gathered, and the persons that they had gotten in Haran. And they set forth to go to the land of Canaan. When they came to the land of Canaan, Abram passed through the land to a place at Sherek to the oaks of Moreh. At the time the Canaanites were in the land, then the Lord appeared to Abram and said, to your descendants I will give this land. So he built there an altar to the Lord who had appeared to him. Thence he removed to the mountains on the east of Bethel and pitched his tent, with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. And there he built an altar to the Lord and called on the name of the Lord. Our second reading is from Matthew 28, verses 18 through 20. And Jesus came and said to them, all authorities in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations. Baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always to close of the age. May God add his blessings to these readings.
Friends, I want to speak with you today about mission. This past week, we had a family friend pass away. He died suddenly in his sleep. He had an undiagnosed heart condition. His name was also Wayne, my first name. What a wonderful person. His mission was to encourage those that he supported, whether they were friends, family members, or others who were part of his fandoms. His passions were to encourage people and to live life fully. What a good man he was. He lived a blessed life. He was blessed to be a blessing, and I am richer for having known him and will miss him very much. He was a good man and good to our family. Well, as I said, mission. The purpose of the church is mission. Mission is what we do. Mission is what a church does. As Emil Brunner said, he was a progressive theologian who passed away, I believe, in the 80s. Anyway, he said, the church exists for mission as fire exists for burning. So So mission is our purpose. And during this transition time, during this interim season, there are certain tasks and questions that we are addressing. And I won't be as explicit about them in the weeks to come because we've mentioned them several times, but you need to see them in the background of the comments that we're going to make going forward. But let me mention it again at least one more time. So these are certain questions and tasks. Connections. Who's our audience? Who are we trying to serve? In other words, it's the question of who's our neighbor. That's really what we're asking. And then leadership, questions about leadership and the future are really questions about who do we want to be and what do we want to do with the challenges ahead? What kind of new leadership is needed here? What are the trends, the hopes, and the aspirations for the future that drive the decisions that are being made in these months? So those are questions about the future. Then there's the question of heritage and mission. And these are questions about identity. Who are you? What is this place? Who are these people? What is their calling? Who have you been? And what is your passion? So these are questions that we're exploring as we go forward. We're talking about values, what's really important. And a mission statement, of course, is something that you already have as a church. This congregation has a mission statement. Individuals typically have statements about purpose, about what's important to them. But the idea of having a statement that's more like a slogan. I was part of an organization and their statement was really this: there are no limits to caring. A church in Dayton, Ohio, their mission statement is a pretty good church. One hospital uses the acronym I Care, which stands for integrity, compassion, attitude, respect, and exceptional quality. And in the United Church of Christ, of which this is a denomination, the church here in Attleboro, they have a statement that says, to love is to care, and to care is to do. So based on the geography and the unique circumstances of this particular congregation, ask yourself, what is something that only this church can do? What is it that only this church can accomplish in this setting, in this place, in this time? This is about values, about the DNA of the church, about those things that you hold most dear, things like community, spirituality, and openness to mystery, wisdom-based, growth and action, and so on. What's your purpose? What gifts, calls, challenges do you claim? Remember, it's about who you are and where you come from. That's what we're talking about when we talk about identity. And here's the thought experiment, a question that helps to kind of bring this home. If you had 24 hours to live, how would you spend those hours? What values are embedded in that kind of a thought experiment? What's important to you? Mission is who we are. And again, it's mission with, not mission for. It's accompaniment, not charity or trying to convert someone. When a friend is sick, we sit with them. We don't seek to get them saved, but we are rather alongside them. And at the Second Congregational Church here in Attleboro, Massachusetts, on the website it says that we are united by a covenant and seek to walk in the ways of Christ in spiritual freedom and in social responsibility. And in the bylaws of this particular congregation, we read that the object of this church, this was written some years ago, but it could be, it's the idea of mission. The object of this church shall be to bind together followers of Jesus Christ for the purpose of sharing in the worship of God and of making God's will dominant in people's lives individually and collectively, and to maintain a center of Christian life and influence in our community. That's a mouthful. That's a mindful, that's a heartful, filled response. So mission is your purpose. It is a value statement. It is the consummate expression of that. Mission is the Great Commission, the great co-mission. We are fellow ministers with God and with one another in the completion of this mission. And even in the face of doubt and commitment, you hear the word of the Lord where Jesus says in his commission, great commission, his grand commission, God authorized me, go out and train everyone you meet far and near in this way of life, marking them by baptism and so on. Then instruct them in the practice that I have commanded you, and I will be with you day after day right up until the end. That's from the Message translation of the Bible in Matthew chapter 18. And for evangelicals, and most of history, the church, of course, was about the cross. The gospel, the good news, was about the cross and resurrection. That was the message of the church. The mission of the church was to get that message out. And that continues on to the present day. It's a challenging message. The mission today in the United Church of Christ is largely focused on peace and justice issues. For without love of neighbor, there can be no love of God, as our brother John says in 1 John. So mission is to be with. It's whether you're a coach or a cheerleader, a nurse or a parent, a spiritual social worker, that's your calling, that's my calling. And evangelism, which is a sibling of mission, evangelism, somebody said, is one beggar telling another beggar where to get bread. And that's an important consideration. We want people to be fed, both spiritually and physically. But what is your particular commission, your commission? It says here in the Bible, it's to train others to walk in a particular way, to share a specific message, which is the good news. We read, and we read earlier in Genesis chapter 12, the story of the call of Abraham, Abram, as he was known. Now the Lord said, I want you to go from where you are, from your country, from your family. You are leaving, and I'll show you, and I'll make a great nation out of you, and I will bless you, and I will make your name great. Why? And this is really the center of my thoughts for you today. So, why? So that you will be a blessing. Blessed to be a blessing. Not to hoard the blessing, but to give it away. And God says in the scripture in that chapter, I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse those who curse you, and in you all the families of the earth will be blessed. So, be you a blessing is literally what the Hebrew construction says there. The Great Commission and the call of Abraham, these things have not changed, nor have they been rescinded. The Apostle Paul tells us that we are ambassadors or messengers of this good news in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. The message there is that God is love and God is not angry with us. Therefore, we should be good neighbors to one another. Sounds like something Mr. Rogers would have said. And by the way, you may not know, but Mr. Rogers was also a Presbyterian minister. He was also a Christian minister. So your life and mine, our entire lives are opportunities for ministry, because mission is ministry and ministry is service. So that's the posture that we have, as we said last time. There's a poem from Rabbi Kushner. Rabbi Kushner is a retired rabbi from in Natick, Massachusetts, nearby, and I've read probably all of his books. His most famous book is Good Things. Why do good things happen to bad people? Or why do bad things happen to good people? Let me get that right. That could be a title of another book. But why bad things happen to good people? And he talks in that book about suffering. And that's not our purpose today, but many good comments there. He has a poem in his writing. I just wanted to refer to part of it. He's talking about life as a jigsaw puzzle and how we are pieces of the puzzle. So just read a few verses from that poem. He says, but know this, no one has within themselves all the pieces to their puzzle. Like before the days when they used to seal jigsaw puzzles in cellophane, ensuring that all the pieces were there. Everyone carries with them at least one and probably many pieces of someone else's puzzle. Sometimes they know it, sometimes they don't. And when you present your piece, which is worthless to you, to another, whether you know it or not, whether they know it or not, you are a messenger from the Most High. Those puzzle pieces fitting together. So mission is about taking our lives and fitting it together in a way that creates this beautiful completed puzzle. So keep going. It's a grand commission that we have. Keep going. Keep making disciples. Keep doing the work that we're called to do. Whatever the label is, whether a messenger or an ambassador, a missionary, an evangelist, a preacher, a friend, a witness, a good neighbor, keep sharing the good news. The world needs the good news, and only you can bring it from your perspective. Your thumbprint is unique. We need your good news. The scriptures today are challenging, perhaps especially the story of the call of Abraham, because like him, we are called in Christ to give up what is most treasured in our lives and to set out into unknown futures and sometimes unknown places. The gospel calls us to embrace uncertainty through faith. And during this time of quarantine, we need to ask ourselves, where is God working in my life, in my church, in my community, in my nation, in my world? We've seen a tremendous upheaval. God, the Spirit, is at work. And to what might God be calling me just at this moment when I've grown comfortable and perhaps retired from my previous life? No one is retired from the good news and the work of the gospel. There's no retirement from spiritual growth. My friend Wayne, who passed away a few days ago, he was just 52. And this past week, I also officiated at a funeral here in Attleboro for a man who was 72. Both of these individuals, much beloved by their families, by their networks, by their friends. What a gift. Take time to think about the brevity of life and our purpose here in a long line of servants, in a long line of good news bearers. The interim work during the transition time, again, is descriptive and only partially prescriptive. You must find your way. I am here to help guide you, to encourage you, to ask some sometimes difficult questions. I'm here to describe the congregation's reality and help to facilitate sometime difficult questions around that reality. So our attitude is crucial. What about abundance and scarcity? We've talked about that before. What about asset mapping? What's available to us? What's not available here? We work with what we have. So our mission, our purpose, is a co-mission with God and with one another. We remember who we are and where we come from. That's our heritage. That's our legacy. That informs our calling here. So keep at it. Don't lose heart. You are blessed to be a blessing to all people. And it may be hard as churches are in decline in general, but it's the call to which it's the mission to which we've been called. So I celebrate you, and I ask you to continue to be strong and stand. Join me in fulfilling the mission to which God the Spirit has called us in this place. Amen. May it be so.
To avoid him.
And now receive this benediction from our brother, the Apostle Paul. Peace be to all of our siblings, brothers and sisters, in love with faith from God, who is our Heavenly Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace be with all who love our Lord Jesus Christ with an undying love. Amen. Go in peace.